the flows, of course. Well, now hear from Marilia Maciel with Diplo Foundation. Last but not least, Marilia, over to you. The microphone, Marilia, please.
Thank you. I'm going to just to share my screen. I believe you can see that. You can see my screen?
Not yet, I'm afraid.
Okay, let me try
Maybe
again.
Maybe we can try
again. Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation, for the European Internet Forum, for the invitation to be here and to host this this session today. And when we were preparing this session, we were discussing the angle that I should take coming from academia and civil society, and it was suggested to me that I could take a development perspective on these discussions. And I think it was a very happy idea because being Brazilian born, I am very sensitive to these discussions. And Diplo Foundation is also very dedicated to providing capacity building that is targeted at developing countries and least developed countries. We are starting, for instance, an e-commerce course now in the month of May that is targeted at these countries. And our idea is that this country should be given information so they can more fully, comprehensively participate on international negotiations and discussions. But before getting to the GSI, I think that an important starting point to this discussion is that when GSI negotiations started back in 2019, the world was at a very different point. I'm sure that we all heard during the past year how the pandemic has accelerated digitalization, how it has accelerated the uptake of e-commerce. However, just only recently, the first reports produced by international organizations are coming through, showing that this uptake and this digitalization has been very unequal across the world. For instance, UNCTAD and WTO have pointed out how large-sized businesses have adapted much more quickly to the new scenario and how they have already in place when the pandemic started, well-developed e-commerce ecosystems that allow them to take advantage of the scenario in which everyone is moving to online and to e-commerce flourishing. At the same time, small and medium-sized enterprises were less able to scale up their processes to respond to this new scenario of online shopping, and the acceleration of e-commerce has significantly taken place mostly in developed countries and high-income developing economies. And all these reports, they are corroborated by the fact that if we take a look at the increase on internet usage across the world, we notice that in 2020, high-income countries have increased their use of the internet by almost 13%. At the same time, lower-income countries have increased their use only by 1%. Which shows that they did not have the conditions in place to migrate to the use of the internet and to take advantage of this new scenario. This is reinforcing divides that already existed before the pandemic. There are very good reports that have been published by the World Bank, the World Economic Forum in the last 10 years that show that we have a situation of great inequality. And this inequality has been worsened by the pandemics, not only among countries, but also within countries. And this is a problem that has been flagged in the report that has been published by the World Economic Forum in the beginning of the year. The WEF does an evaluation of the threats that we can see that would cause harm to our societies from an economic, from a democratic standpoint. And it was the first year in which issues of digital power concentration and digital inequality were ranked among the top 10 issues with regards to the likelihood of these global threats. So inequality will become a threat to global stability. This is not just a problem for developing countries only, this is a systemic problem. And if e-commerce is key to economic recovery, Then the GSI and the negotiations in the WTO, they become strategic to ensure that these countries that have been more severely hit by the crisis, they can embrace e-commerce as a way to leverage their economic recovery as well. So I think that when the negotiations started, development was already a concern, but now it's a much more important concern than before, because global stability depends on that as well. But if we look at the GSI and the membership of the GSI, we are facing a diverse group, a group that corresponds to more than 80% of a global trade, as was mentioned before, a group that counts now with 86 participants, that does have the participation of six countries from Africa, four LDCs. So it is a diverse group that has the conditions to tackle many of the difficult problems that we face today to leverage e-commerce. However, there are many countries that do not participate in the GSI. And some arguments that these countries have presented not to participate, they vary a lot. I try to map some of them, and some of them have come across in our courses. We offer our courses to diplomats, and these are some of the issues that that they mention. First of all, many of them still see the working program on electronic commerce as the home for e-commerce discussions in the WTO. And this is the place in which the whole WTO membership is able to participate and to contribute, and they believe that discussions should be invigorated there at the first place. Secondly, they mentioned that there are some very important unresolved issues that need to be tackled first before we are in the condition to move forward to an agreement on e-commerce, such as the classification of services. Some argue that we need a new classification of new services in order to be able to have more clarity to regulate this field. Others mentioned that the principle of technological neutrality is not clearly defined, and there is the forever issue on whether electronic transmission should be regarded as goods or services, which has not been tackled as well. Many developing countries do not have regulation on the national level. So without this blueprint, it's very hard for them to advance their interests on the international level. They do not have any base to negotiate. And they do not want international regulations to constrain their policy space. If they do not have any regulation in place, they need to assess whether certain laws would be on their national interests or not, and they would want to have a blank page and full conditions to assess that. Some believe that there has been not a sufficient mainstreaming of development issues in the GSI. Some say that this is a development round, so there are other issues that have been in the agenda of the Doha rounds that have not been resolved that would have a much more serious impact on development, such as agriculture issues. The strength of negotiators in the WTO should be focused on these issues. And lastly, they mentioned that proposed e-commerce regulations at the WTO are advancing in fields which belong to internet governance, to digital governance, and that do not necessarily belong in the WTO. And data flows is one example of that. Data flows, they are everything in our life. So the data that flows on the internet does not only relate to goods and services. There are many other types of data circulating, and a provision on data flows would regulate data flows as a whole, therefore expanding the remit of the WTO to non-trade issues as well. And according to them, this is an issue of concern. At the same time, some developing countries have joined the GSI, so they see the reason to participate. And most of them say that there's already so many countries participating in the GSI that there is no way that this process is not moving forward, and they prefer to be rule makers instead of rule takers, and that the only way to mainstream development concerns is to be part of the negotiations. If you're not at the table, no one will hear your arguments. And at the same time, they argue that the fact that they do not have national regulations on some of these issues is not a handicap to participate. On the contrary, if they abide by laws on the multilateral level this could provide them with a starting point to develop national laws. And this is a very good point because it is a clear understanding of the function of the WTO. WTO is not there to regulate privacy, cybersecurity, or data flows in the nitty-gritty level. It will provide general principles, and the countries will regulate on the national level on the way that aligns with the international regulation, but they will have some space to decide what's best for them. And finally, some researchers have suggested that liberalization in some areas, such as data flows, they would benefit even countries that are less connected to the global flows of data today. So they would have spillover effects that would be positive for developing countries too. The documents that are produced in WTO negotiations, they are not public. There are proposals that have been tabled by Canada and New Zealand, for instance, to make these documents, at least the chair's summary, public in the sake of transparency. However, as was mentioned before, the last chair's summary has been leaked, so it is available online. At Diplo, we try to map the positions of some of the key players to try to understand in which areas developed and developing countries are focusing on. This is a comparison between the different areas in which these countries have tabled concrete proposals. It's interesting to see that among developing countries, Brazil has been a very active country. China is active almost all across the board, but it has been very silent in the section on openness and e-commerce. So it has not table proposals on data flows, although we know that China does have positions on data flows. It has agreed on data flows provisions with many exceptions in the RCEP. We see that the European Union, the United States, they are focused on openness and e-commerce. And of course, as was mentioned before, the European Union is also heavily engaged on telecommunications discussions. Here is a mapping trying to focus on the different areas in which developing countries have tabled positions. The first thing to notice is that developing countries have not as a whole been very vocal in these discussions, although some of them have, such as Brazil and China. But their proposals, they focus more on the first sections of the consolidated summary, enabling e-commerce. A lot of proposals have come through on trust and electronic commerce. It's interesting to see that developing countries are tabling many proposals on access to the source code, because they see a concern that if they don't have provisions on this particular topic that would allow technology transfer, these negotiations could have a negative impact on the capacity of developing countries to ask for technology transfer as performance requirements. So they are focusing on that, and this is interesting from a development perspective.